Pollution in part two. Right, let's start. Evolution. First thing, what is evolution?
Change over time.
Yeah, so evolution, it's change over time. It's change over time. So now there's an argument as to whether evolution is a theory or is a hypothesis. But now before we conclude whether evolution is a theory or a hypothesis, we need to understand what is a theory and also what is a hypothesis. All right. What is a theory? Right. So a theory, it's an explanation that, or it's an explanation for a phenomena that has been observed in nature that is accepted as the truth because it's supported by evidence and facts. But now, what is a hypothesis?
Testable statement.
The hypothesis is a testable statement. It's a testable statement. So a theory, it's an explanation for a phenomena that has been scientifically accepted as the truth because it is backed by evidence and facts. Whereas a hypothesis is a tentative explanation for a phenomena that can be tested and proven by further investigation. In other words, a hypothesis is a testable statement. Now, is evolution a theory or a hypothesis? Yeah, so evolution is a theory. Why are we saying evolution is a theory? It's because it is backed by evidence, right? Now, the question is, what is the evidence of evolution? Right, number one, we have fossil evidence. Fossil evidence. Number two, we have genetic evidence. Number three, we have, okay, not yet. We have biogeography. Cultural evidence is the evidence for human evolution. We're still talking about evolution. Right, and then the last one is, so we have fossil evidence, genetic evidence, biogeography, and we have modification by descent. Sometimes called homologous structures. Structures. So if a question says to you, how does fossils serve as an evidence of evolution? How does fossils serve as an evidence of evolution? Right, you're going to say, right, so remember, fossils are remains of organisms that have lived in the past, right? And these remains of organisms, they are mineralized, which means they are found in rocks, yeah? Are we together? So, when they check the rocks, they find that the oldest rocks, so say this is a sedimentary rock. So the oldest rocks contain the simplest fossils. And the newest rocks contains the most complex fossils. Which means that this fossil has changed over time. Right? So that is fossil evidence. The oldest rocks contain the simplest fossils and the newest rocks contain the most complex fossils. Right. Now, when we look at genetic evidence, we are saying that if different organisms have the same structure of genes, they have the same sequence of genes, and they have the same mutation, it means that they share a common ancestor. For example, when you look at the human beings and the chimpanzees, what is it that they share in common? They share what? A common ancestor, isn't it? Right. So why are we saying that they share a common ancestor? What is one evidence that tells you that they share a common ancestor? It's because their DNA is similar. Right, and then now we have biogeography. Biogeography, it means the study of the past and the present distribution of organisms. Right. When we talk of biogeography, we are speaking about speciation, right? Yeah, there's a scientist which was called Alfred Wegener that pinned the theory which was called continental drift, where he said that the Earth was one big land mass called Pangaea, and it's separated into two, isn't it? Into what? Gondwana land and Laurasia. So when the Earth separated, the organisms were distributed into different environmental conditions. And we know that if we change the environmental condition, then natural selection take place, isn't it? Right. And then we have homologous structures. So homologous structures, those are structures which looks the same but perform different functions. Those are homologous structures. Different structures in different organisms, and they perform different functions, but they look the same. Those are homologous structures. So we are saying that if different organisms have the same anatomical plan, it means that they share a common ancestor. Right. So now evolution cannot take place until there's variation. Right. Who can tell me what is variation? What is variation? What is variation? Yes? Different of species. No, variation means differences in organisms of the same species. That's variation. Variation, it means differences in organisms of the same species. That's variation. And now you need to know the sources of variation. That yes, we are of the same species. We belong to Homo sapien, but you are not the same. We are varied. What causes variation? Right. We remember the sources of variation by saying C R R M. So C for crossing over, random arrangement of chromosomes during metaphase, random fertilization, random mating, and then mutation. Right. So these are sources of variation, right? It's crossing over, random arrangement of chromosomes, random fertilization, random mating, and then mutation. Then from there, you need to know two types of variation. There's what? Continuous variation and discontinuous variation. So these are types of variation. So you have continuous variation and discontinuous variation. Right. Continuous variation is a variation where there is a range of intermediate phenotypes for a particular characteristic. There's a range of intermediate phenotypes for a particular characteristic. For example, its height, its skin tone, its shoe size. Those are examples of a continuous variation, a variation that continues. Yeah, if you like, you have someone who's tall, taller, tallest, or you can have someone who's short, shorter, shortest. So this variation in terms of height, it continues, skin tone and shoe size. And then you have discontinuous variation, right? Discontinuous variation is a variation where there is no range of different intermediate phenotypes for a particular characteristic. So this variation, it stops, it doesn't continue. An example of discontinuous variation would be blood groups. What else? Gender. Yeah, it's either you are a male or you are a female. Yes. It's either you belong to blood group A, B, AB, or blood group O. Right? So those are examples of discontinuous and continuous variation. Right? Let's just do a quick recap. We said evolution is change over time, right? And then we said a theory, it's an explanation for a phenomena that is accepted as the truth because it's backed by evidence and facts. Whereas a hypothesis, we said it's a tentative explanation for a phenomena that can be tested and proven by further investigation. But a short explanation is that it's a testable statement. And now we said that evolution is a theory. The reason why we are saying it's a theory is because it is backed by evidence and facts. And there are four sources of evidence that we can draw from. It's fossil evidence, genetic evidence, biogeography, homologous structures. Right. And then we said that evolution cannot take place until there's variation. But now what is variation? Variation, it's the differences in organisms of the same species. And then we said that there's five sources of variation. It's crossing over, random arrangement of chromosomes, random fertilization, random mating, and then mutation. Right, so if a question asks you, name two sources of variation that we find in meiosis. It's crossing over and random arrangement of chromosomes. And then we spoke about the two types of variation. We have continuous variation and discontinuous variation. All right. Now let's go to evolution by Lamarck. Lamarck. Right. So Lamarck tried to explain how evolution takes place. In his quest, he came up with two laws. Eh? What is the first law? Law of use and disuse. And then what is the second law? Law of the inheritance. Law of the inheritance of acquired characteristics. Right. Now, what does the law of use and disuse state? Right. It states that. Wait. So it states that if you use an organism, if you use an organ more often, if you use a structure or an organ more often, that structure will become better developed and elongated. And if an organism does not use a structure more often, that structure will shrink until it disappears. Right? So that's the law of use and disuse. If an organism uses a structure more often, that structure will become better developed and elongated. Right? And if an organism does not use a structure more often, that structure will shrink and disappear. Right? And then now we have the second law, which is the law of the inheritance of acquired characteristics. Right, so this law, it states that the characteristics that an organism has acquired in a lifetime can be passed on to the next generation. The characteristics that an organism has acquired in a lifetime can be passed on to the next generation. Right, let's explain these laws. So the law of use and disuse, it basically means that if you are going to use your hands more often, right, to do whatsoever you want to do. Right, so it means that your hands will become better developed and elongated. And that characteristics of long hands will then be passed on to the next generation. In other words, your children will be born with long hands. All right. Now, if a question comes to you and shows you a diagram of a giraffe, right. Okay. So if a question comes and says, use the laws of Lamarck to explain the development of long necks in giraffes. So now they are saying the development of long necks in giraffes, which means the giraffes originally, they had short necks, isn't it? Right. Now, how do you go about answering this question? So you are going to say, originally, number one, originally, giraffes had short necks. Originally, giraffes had short necks. Point number two, they used their necks more often to reach the food on high trees. Point number three. All right. Originally, giraffes had short necks. Second point, they used their necks more often to reach the food on high trees. Number three, as a result. Their necks became better developed and elongated. So, originally giraffes had short necks. They used their necks more often to reach the food on high trees. As a result, their necks became better developed and elongated. Point number four, the characteristics of long necks was then passed on to the next generation. And then eventually, all giraffes had short necks, had long necks, sorry. Right, so again, we are saying, if the question says, explain the development of long necks in giraffes using Lamarck. So we say, originally, giraffes had short necks. They use their necks more often to reach the food on high trees. As a result, their necks became better developed and elongated. Then the characteristics of long necks was then passed on to the next generation. Eventually, all giraffes had long necks. Right. But now, if a question comes again and say, use Lamarck, the laws of Lamarck, to explain why is it that the snakes do not have legs. Use the laws of Lamarck. Hey, it's a snake now. Use the laws of Lamarck. Hey, shh. Use the laws of Lamarck to explain why is it that the snakes do not have legs. So you're going to say, originally, snakes had legs. Originally, snakes had legs. That's point number one. Point number two, they did not use their legs more often. Point number three, as a result, their legs shrinked until they disappeared. And then point number four, the characteristic of no legs was then passed on to the next generation. And then eventually, all the snakes did not have legs. So we have explained the laws of use using the giraffe, and you've explained the law of disuse using the snake. Right, this is the laws of Lamarck. Right, but now these laws of Lamarck, they were rejected. And the reason why they were rejected is because, number one, it's very important. They'll ask you, why is it that the laws of Lamarck were rejected? They were rejected because acquired characteristics cannot be passed on to the next generation. Did you get that? Why was it rejected? Acquired characteristics cannot be passed on to the next generation. Number one. Acquired characteristics cannot be passed on to the next generation. The second reason why they rejected these laws is because organisms, they do not evolve because they want to. Right. So since these laws were rejected, then there must be another theory, accepted theory for evolution. And that theory is called natural selection by Charles Darwin. So Charles Darwin explained how evolution takes place by the process called natural selection. Right. Now we had Lamarck, now it's time for us to hear Darwin. So Charles Darwin, when he explains natural selection, he starts by saying, all right, number one, there's a great deal of variation amongst offsprings. There's a great deal of variation amongst the offsprings. Great deal of variation amongst the offsprings. Right, in the second point, he explains the variation. He says, some organisms had favorable characteristics and some organisms had unfavorable characteristics. So he first says, in point number one, there's a great deal of variation amongst the offsprings. The second point, he explains the variation. He says some offsprings had favorable characteristics and some offsprings had unfavorable characteristics. And then point number three. He says now when there's a change in the environment that sparks competition for survival. When there's a change in the environment, that sparks competition for survival. Then point number four, obviously, organisms with favorable characteristics will survive. And organisms with unfavorable characteristics will die. So first point, there's a great deal of variation amongst offsprings. Second point, he explains the variation. Some offsprings have favorable characteristics and some offsprings have unfavorable characteristics. Point number three, now when there's a change in the environment, when there's a change in the environment, there's now a competition for survival. Point number four, organisms with favorable characteristics survive, and organisms with unfavorable characteristics, they die. And then point number five, the organisms that survive, they reproduce. These organisms that survive, they reproduce, and they pass on the allele of a favorable characteristic to their offspring or to the next generation. And then point number six, eventually, there's a great proportion of organisms with favorable characteristics. That's natural selection, right? And then point number six, eventually, there's a great proportion of organisms with favorable characteristics, right? So that is Charles Darwin explaining evolution and how it takes place. Says there's a great deal of variation among offsprings. Says some offsprings have favorable characteristics and some offsprings have unfavorable characteristics. Then he says when there's a change in the environment, those organisms with favorable characteristics will survive, and the ones with unfavorable characteristics will die. And the ones that survive will reproduce and pass on the allele of a favorable characteristics to the next generation. And eventually, we have a great proportion of organisms with favorable characteristics. All right, now if we go back to this diagram, this structure again, and then now they are saying, using the theory of natural selection, explain why is it, or explain the development of long necks in giraffes. So we are going to say there was a great deal of variation amongst giraffes. You mentioned the species. There's a great deal of variation amongst giraffes. That's point number one. Point number two, you explain the variation. Some giraffes had long necks and some giraffes had short necks. And then point number three, when food ran out on lower trees, that's a change in the environment. When food ran out on lower trees, the giraffes with long necks, point number four, giraffes with long necks survived because they could reach the food on high trees. And giraffes with short necks, they died because they could not reach the food on high trees. Then point number five, the giraffes that survived reproduced and passed on the allele of long necks to their offsprings. And then eventually, there's a great proportion of giraffes with long necks. Are we fine? Right. Now let's go to artificial selection. Artificial selection. Artificial selection, it means that it's the selection and the breeding of organisms with desirable characteristics by humans. Artificial selection, it means it's the selection It's the selection and breeding of organisms with desirable characteristics. By humans. That is artificial selection. Is the selection and the breeding of organisms with desirable characteristics by humans. That's artificial selection. Right. So how does it take place? Human beings, they are going to select organisms with desirable characteristics, interbreed them, then they are going to produce offsprings. And then from the offsprings, they are going to select organisms with desirable characteristics and breed them. And repeat that process until they reach a desired outcome. Right? If I was you, I was going to write that down. Mm-hmm. So humans, they select organisms with desirable characteristics and breed them, and they'll produce offsprings. Then from the offsprings, they'll select organisms with desirable characteristics and breed them, and repeat that process until they reach a desired outcome. So if they say to you, for example, a farmer, now my cattle farmer, wants to start a business where he sells milk, but there are few cows that produce a lot of milk from his farm. Explain how he can use artificial selection to increase the number of cows that produce a lot of milk. So you are going to say the farmer will select the cows that produce a lot of milk, breed them together, and then they'll produce offsprings. And then from the offsprings, he will select the cows that produce a lot of milk and breed them together. And repeat that process until he reaches a desired outcome. All right. Then they'll also ask you to tabulate the differences between artificial selection and natural selection. The first thing you do is that you draw a table. After drawing a table, you write natural selection. Don't write NS, write natural selection. And then here you write artificial selection. Then you are going to get 1 mark for a table. Right. Now, what is the difference between natural selection and artificial selection? Right, it's mostly 5 marks, which is 1 mark for a table, then 1 mark for the differences. Difference number one is that natural selection, the environment represents a selective force. The environment is a selective force. In natural selection, it's the environment that decides which organisms survive. So the environment is the selective force. Whereas in artificial selection, humans represent a selective force. Humans represent a selective force. Right. Number two, right, number two, in natural selection, evolution occurs within a species. It takes place within a species. It takes place within a species. Natural selection takes place within a species. That's why we are going to say, a population, I mean, there was a great deal of variation amongst giraffes. So it happens within a species. Whereas in artificial selection, it can happen across different species. It can happen across different species. Can happen across different species. All right. We'll just do a quick recap before we move on. Right. We spoke about Lamarck. We said Lamarck came up with two laws, laws of use and disuse, right? And the second law is the law of the inheritance of acquired characteristics, right? So the law of use and disuse, we said it states that if an organism uses a structure more often, that structure will become better developed and elongated. And if an organism does not use a structure more often, that structure will shrink until it disappears. Nah? Then the second law, it's the law of the inheritance of acquired characteristics, which states that the characteristics that an organism has acquired in a lifetime can be passed on to the next generation. Right. Then we said that if a question comes and says, explain the development of long necks in giraffes using Lamarck. So you're going to say, originally, all giraffes had short necks. Hey, what happened? They used their necks more often to reach the food on high trees. As a result, their necks became better developed and elongated. Then the characteristics of long necks was then passed on to the next generation, right? Then eventually, all giraffes had long necks. So there's no variation when it comes to Lamarck. And then if they say to you, explain why is it that the snakes do not have legs, you are going to say, no, originally, snakes had legs. The problem is that they did not use their legs more often. And as a result, their legs shrinked until they disappeared. Then the characteristics of no legs was then passed on to the next generation. Eventually, all the snakes did not have legs, right? But then we said, now these laws of Lamarck were rejected. The reason why they rejected, number one, is because acquired characteristics cannot be passed on to the next generation. And then number two, organisms do not evolve because they want to. Right, and then we spoke about natural selection. We said that there's a great deal of variation among offsprings. Eh? And then number two, we explained the variation. Some have favorable characteristics and some have unfavorable characteristics. And then number three, there's a problem. When there's a change in the environment, those with favorable characteristics, they survive. And those with unfavorable characteristics, they die. And the ones that survive reproduce and pass on the allele of favorable characteristics to the next generation. Mm-hmm. Right. And then now we spoke about artificial selection. We said it's the selection and the breeding of organisms with desirable characteristics. And then we spoke about the differences. Right. Now, question is, what is punctuated equilibrium? What is punctuated equilibrium? Yes. Sharp. Right. Punctuated equilibrium, it's a hypothesis that explains the speed at which evolution takes place. That is punctuated equilibrium. It's a hypothesis that explains the speed at which evolution takes place. So a scientist that came up with punctuated equilibrium is called Neil Eldridge. It's Eldridge and Wold. And Kult, sorry. Right, it's Eldridge. It's Neil Eldridge and Kult. Right. Now, what does punctuated equilibrium state? Right. So now we have time and then we have change. Right. Punctuated equilibrium, it states that evolution involves a long period of time where there's no change. And this alternates with a short period of time where there's rapid change through natural selection. If I was you, I was going to write that down because I'll tell you why Monday. Right. So punctuated equilibrium, it states that evolution involves a long period of time where there is no change. And this alternates with a short period of time where there's rapid change through natural selection. That is punctuated equilibrium. Right, are we fine? Can we move now? Right. Now, there's what we call speciation. Speciation. The word speciation, it means the formation of new species. The formation of new species. That is speciation. It means the formation of new species. Right. So if a question comes to you and say, explain speciation using geographic isolation, then you must say, number one, if a population of a single species becomes separated by a geographical barrier. Right, if a population of a single species becomes separated by a geographical barrier, point number two, obviously the population will split, isn't it? Yeah, it will split into two, provided that that geographical barrier is separating the population into two. Right, so if a population of a single species becomes separated by a geographical barrier, the population will split into two. Point number three, there is now no gene flow between the two populations. Point number four, since the two populations are now exposed to different environmental conditions, natural selection will take place independently, such that they become different from each other genotypically and phenotypically. And even if they were to mix again, they would not interbreed and produce fertile offsprings. All right. Okay, let's go back. Right, so we are saying that if they say to you, explain speciation using geographic isolation, so you are going to say Now, if a population of a single species becomes separated by a geographical barrier, number one, if a population of a single species becomes separated by a geographical barrier, number two, the population will split into two. Number three, there is no gene flow between the two populations. Number four, since the two populations are now exposed to different environmental conditions, natural selection will take place independently in each population, such that the two populations become different from each other genotypically and phenotypically. And even if these two populations were to mix again, they would not interbreed and produce fertile offsprings. All right. Now let's explain it using the application of theory. All right. So let's say now we have a pond or a dam. Yeah. Right. So in this dam, there's species of fish, isn't it? And then there's variation there because we know that there's always variation, isn't it? Right. There are fishes which are blue. And there are ones that are black. O look at the fishes there. Right, so we have two types of fish. We have blue fish and then we have black fish. Right, so if this population becomes separated by a strip of land, right, so this is the original population. So this population is separated by a strip of land. Separated by a strip of land. Of water or of land, ne? Right. Now we have these fishes here. All right. So now, let's say this one is a duck river, maybe duck pond, or here it's a blue. Right. So if they say to you, use the diagram above to explain the formation, let's give these fishes names. What name can we give this one? Yeah? Naled. And then this one? Sihle. All right. So now they are asking you explain. using speciation, the formation of a species called Sihle and another one called Naledi in the fishes. Right. So can we pay attention? Right. So we are going to say, right, the population of fishes was separated by a strip of land. The population split into two. There was no gene flow between the two populations. Since the two populations were now exposed to different environmental conditions, then you explain that different environmental condition. Some they were found in a blue dam, and others they were found in a dark dam. Right. Since the two populations are exposed to different environmental conditions, some are found in a blue dam and some are found in a dark dam. Natural selection took place independently in each population, such that they became different. The fish became different from each other genotypically and phenotypically. And even if they were to mix again, they would not interbreed and produce fertile offsprings. Hey. Right. So you can see that here in a dark dam, the ones that are dark colored, they survive, right? Why? Because they are camouflaged. And the ones that are blue, they die because they are easily exposed. Can you see it? Right, did you get that one? Or should we do another example? The last example. Right. So if they show you, right. Now, let's say this is Africa. And then here we are going to have Australia. Right. And then we have dogs. Here we have what you call jackals. And then here we have coyote. Right. And they ask you, explain the formation of jackals and the coyote in the dog family. Right. Using speciation. Right. Explain the formation of the jackal and the coyote in the dog family using speciation. So you are going to say the population of a dog family was separated by the ocean. The population split into two. There was no gene flow between the two populations. Since the two populations were exposed to different environmental conditions, natural selection took place independently in each population, such that the two populations became different from each other genotypically and phenotypically. And even if they were to mix again, they would not interbreed and produce fertile offsprings. Right. Now let's do mechanisms of reproductive isolation. Mechanisms of reproductive isolation. Oh, yeah. All right. So we have five mechanisms of reproductive isolation. What are those? Those are mechanisms that keep organisms which are not of the same species separate. Right. Mechanisms. If I was you, I was going to write notes instead of checking the book. Eh? It helps. Of reproductive. Mechanisms of reproductive isolation. Those are mechanisms that keep species separate. or keeps organisms of different species separate. Right, we have five. The first one is species-specific courtship behavior. Species-specific courtship behavior. Species-specific courtship behavior. Yeah, species-specific courtship behavior. That if different organisms have different courtship behaviors, then they won't be able to interbreed. Right. Number two, it's being adapted to different pollinating agents. Being adapted to different pollinating agents. Right. So flowers reproduce by a process called pollination, which is a transfer of pollen from an anther of one plant to the stigma of another plant. That's called cross-pollination. Right, but this pollination is made possible by the agents, which are called pollinating agents. It can be bees, it can be wind, can be any flies. So if different flowers are adapted to different pollinating agents, then they won't be able to interbreed. Are we together? Right, and then number three. Hey, there's noise there. That disturbs me. Right. Number one, species-specific courtship behavior, being adapted to different pollinating agent. Number three, infertile offsprings. Infertile offsprings. That during artificial selection, if you interbreed organisms of different species, then the offspring will be infertile. Which means the generation ends there. Yeah, it won't reproduce any further. Right, number four, it's breeding at different times of the year. Breeding at different times of the year. Breeding at different times of the year. Right, and then the last one, it's prevention of fertilization. Prevention of fertilization. Prevention of fertilization. Right, what causes that one? Right, who can tell me what causes prevention of fertilization? You can't have a huge animal interbreeding with a small animal because a huge animal has big genitals. Eh? Yeah, so those genitals really, that they cannot, in other words, let me just put it blunt, the penis cannot deposit sperms inside the vagina. So we call that prevention of fertilization because it's too big and the vagina is small. Yeah. All right. Now we go to human evolution. Right. Human evolution. Human evolution. Right. Hey, shh. We are doing human evolution now. Right, but before we go to human evolution, please just know present day evolution. When we are talking about present day evolution, that's when we are talking about resistance, having resistance. So they are going to ask you, maybe a question will come and say, right, explain the development of resistant of bacteria to antibiotics. Explain the development of resistance of bacteria to antibiotics. So you're going to say, now there's a great deal of variation among bacteria. Some bacteria are resistant to antibiotics. and some bacteria are not resistant to antibiotics. When the antibiotics are introduced to their environment, the bacteria that are resistant to antibiotics, they survive. And the ones that are not resistant to antibiotics, they die. And the bacteria that survive, they reproduce and pass on the allele of resistance to their next generation. And eventually, there's a great proportion of bacteria which are resistant to antibiotics. Right. The question is, explain the development of resistance of bacteria to antibiotics. Explain the development of resistance of bacteria to antibiotics. So we are going to say, there's a great deal of variation amongst bacteria. Some bacteria are resistant to antibiotics, and some bacteria are not resistant to antibiotics. When the antibiotics is introduced to their environment, the bacteria that are resistant, they survive. And the bacteria that are not resistant, they die. And the bacteria that survive reproduce and pass on the allele of resistance to their offsprings or to the next generation. Then eventually, there's a great proportion of bacteria that are resistant to antibiotics. Now we are doing human evolution. Human evolution. Right, human evolution. Human evolution. All right. Are you ready for human evolution? Yes. All right. Right, human evolution. Human evolution. All right. So for you to master human evolution, number one, you must know the classification of humans. Classification of humans, number one. Right. Classification of humans. Right. Number one, just know that humans belong to kingdom Animalia. Classification. Number one, kingdom Animalia. Number two, phylum Chordata. Number three, class Mammalia. Number four, order primates. Number five, to what family do human beings belong to? Hominidae. Right, so it's kingdom Animalia, phylum Chordata, class Mammalia, order primates, family Hominidae. Right, and then number six, we have genus. The genus for human beings, it's Homo. And then number seven, it's species. To what species do we belong? We belong to Homo sapiens. Underlined. So when you write Homo sapien, you must ensure that you underline it. Write its kingdom, Animalia, phylum, chordata, class, mammalia, order, primates, family, hominidae, genus, homo, and then species, Homo sapien, underlined. Right. Then from there, you need to know the similarities that human beings share with African apes. Right, you underline the entire thing. Right, everything. Right. Now, we need to know the similarities. Similarities that human beings share with African apes. Okay, I'm trying to draw a human being. Right. So similarities that human beings share with African apes. Number one, we have large brain size. Number two, we have two front eyes. Number three, we have freely rotating arm. Number four, we have long upper arm. Number five, we have rotation at the elbow joint. Number six, we have opposable thumb. Opposable thumb. And then number seven, we have flat nails instead of claws. Right. So these are similarities that human beings share with African apes. So we have large brain size, two front eyes, freely rotating arm, long upper arm, rotation at the elbow joint, opposable thumb, and then flat nails instead of claws. So this is the upper limb. The hand is the upper limb. So if a question says, name the similarities between human beings and African apes in their upper limbs. So obviously it's freely rotating arm, long upper arm, rotation at the elbow joint, opposable thumb, flat nails instead of claws. Right. Those are similarities between human beings and African apes. Similarities between human beings and African apes. Right. Now let's go to differences between human beings and African apes. Are we still together? Are we still together now? Yes. All right. Now the differences between human beings and African apes. So we'll have a human. And then you're going to have an African ape. Nice drawing, eh? Nice. All right. So this is a human. And then this one is an African ape. Right, now they ask you, what is the difference between the human beings and the African ape? Or they say, tabulate visible differences between human beings and African apes. Right.
Humans can.
Number one, African apes have a small cranium size. Humans have a big cranium size. That's number one difference. So, there's a small cranium size compared to this one. Human African apes have a small cranium size. Humans have a large cranium size. Number one. Number two is that African apes have pronounced iproriches. African apes have pronounced iproriches. Humans have less pronounced iproriches. Number three is that African apes have a sloping face. And then humans have a flat face. And then number four, African apes are prognathous. African apes are prognathous. And then humans are non-prognathous, not less. They are non-prognathous. The giraffe is appearing there. Lying again, corn. Right. So, just a review of visible differences. African apes have small cranium size. Human beings have a large cranium size. African apes have pronounced iproriches. Humans have less pronounced iproriches. African apes have a sloping face, whereas humans have a flat face. And then number four, African apes are prognathous, whereas humans are non-prognathous. And then number five, African apes have large canines, whereas humans have small canines. Then number six, African apes have a rectangular shaped palate, and humans have a C-shaped palate. Then number seven. Oh, wait. Right. Number seven. The foramen magnum of African apes is pushed to a more backward position, whereas the foramen magnum of humans is pushed to a more forward position. Right. So those are differences between human beings and African apes. Right. Then now we go to bipedalism. 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 Right. Bipedalism is the ability to walk on two lower limbs. Right. Your hands, they are called your upper limbs. Your legs are called your lower limbs. So bipedalism is the ability to walk on two lower limbs. That is bipedalism. The ability to walk on two lower limbs. Right, there are three factors that affect bipedalism. There are three factors that affect bipedalism. In other words, there are three things that makes organisms who are bipedal to be bipedal. Right, number one is that the foramen magnum is pushed to a more forward position. So foramen magnum is pushed to a more forward position so that the spinal cord can join in vertically. The foramen magnum is pushed to a more forward position so that the spinal cord can join in vertically. That's number one. Number two, the spine is S-shaped. The spine, so we no longer say, we don't say the spinal cord. We say the spine is S-shaped. to allow for flexibility. The spine is S-shaped to allow for flexibility. And then number three, the pelvis is short and wide to support the upper body mass. The pelvis is short and wide to support the upper body mass. So those are three factors that affect bipedalism. Foramen magnum is pushed to a more forward position. The spine is S-shaped. The pelvis is short and wide. Right. Now, we need to know the differences between quadrupedalism and bipedalism. When they say tabulate the differences between quadrupedalism and bipedalism, right, quadrupedalism is the ability to walk on four lower limbs. The ability to walk on four limbs. That is quadrupedalism. Right, so we have bipedalism here, and then we have quadrupedalism. Right, so in bipedalism, the foramen magnum is pushed to a more forward position, whereas in quadrupedalism, the foramen magnum is pushed to a more backward position. And then in bipedalism, the spine is S-shaped, and in quadrupedalism, the spine is C-shaped. And then last one, in quadrupedalism, the pelvis is short and wide, whereas in quadrupedalism, the pelvis is long and narrow. It's long and narrow. So those are differences between bipedalism and quadrupedalism. Right. Then they are going to ask you about, they might ask you about the advantages of bipedalism. What are advantages? What are advantages? Number one is that you have a better field of view. Number one, you have a better field of view. You can see far. You can spot predators from afar. That's number one. And then number two is that movement is easy and efficient. You can move easily and efficiently. Right. Number three is that your hands are free to carry tools. You can use your hands. Your hands are free to carry tools. Right. They won't ask you more than three advantages. Right, now let's come to the evidence of human evolution. If human evolution is really a theory, then there should be evidence of human evolution. Right, evidence of human evolution. Evidence of human evolution. Right. So we have three evidence of human evolution. Number one, we have fossil evidence. Fossil evidence. When we are talking of fossil evidence, we are talking about the transitional fossils. Transitional fossils. Fossils that have characteristics which are common to the ancestor species and the species that follows after. Right. And then number two, we talk of cultural evidence. When we speak about cultural evidence, we are talking about the use of tools. Then the last one is genetic evidence. The last one is genetic evidence. Genetic evidence. So here we are talking about mitochondrial DNA. So these are three evidence of human evolution. It's fossil evidence. We are talking about the transitional species or fossils. And remember, who was this one? Karab. Right? Australopithecus sediba. But we'll go there. It's fine. Right, and then cultural evidence, we are talking about the use of tools. Here we are talking about Homo habilis, handyman, the first one to use tools. And then we speak of mitochondrial DNA when we are talking about genetic evidence. Right, let's explain this evidence further, and then we do out of Africa hypothesis. We look at the phylogenetic trees, and then we are done. All right. Now, when we talk of fossil evidence, we are looking at the fossil record. We are looking at the fossil record. All right. Do you remember the fossil record?
Yes.
Let's see if you can remember it. See, people, you must close your books.
Sure.
Can you close distinction material? Thank you. Hey, these ones, they want monetary value now. They want man. There is. It's fine. Yeah.
Oh.
All right. So remember, on the fossil record, you must know the scientific name. Ne? You must know the scientific name. Right, you must know the scientific name, and then you must know the common name, and then you must know who discovered it. Who discovered it, and then you must know where. Where did they discover it? Right. What was the oldest fossil? Right, so the first one was Ardipithecus ramatus. Right, so what was the common name for Ardipithecus ramatus? It was Ardi. Right, who discovered Ardipithecus ramatus? It was Tim White. Where? In Ethiopia. Right. So the oldest fossil, it was Ardipithecus ramatus. Common name was Ardi. And then Ardi was discovered by Tim White. And then in Ethiopia. Right. After Ardipithecus ramatus, we had who?
Australopithecus.
Afarensis. Right, Australopithecus afarensis, the common name was Lucy. Who discovered Lucy? Johansson. Where?
Ethiopia.
In Ethiopia. Right. After Australopithecus afarensis, we had what?
Australopithecus
africanus. So it's Australopithecus africanus. Ne? Africanus. Australopithecus africanus. Africanus. So there are three, isn't it? Right. The first one is Daung Child. Right. So who discovered Daung Child? It was discovered by Raymond Dartz. Right. Where? In Daung. Right. And then the second one was? Okay, Mrs. Bless. Right, Mrs. Bless was discovered by who? Roberts. Who? Where? In the Sterkfontein, right? And then the last one was Littlefoot. So Littlefoot was discovered by who?
Ron Clark.
Ron Clark. Where? In the Sterkfontein. Sterkfontein. Is it jealous or something? Right. Now, after these species, Australopithecus africanus, we had a transitional fossil. Right. Who was a transitional fossil? Australopithecus Sidiba. Right. What was the common name for Australopithecus Sidiba? Garabo. Hey, now, why is it doing this? Garabo. Right. Who discovered Garabo? It's Prof. Nipega. Ne? Right. Where?
Malapa.
Cradle. Of humankind. Yeah, it's a fossil site. Right. And then after Australopithecus Sidiba, we had who?
Homo habilis.
So we had Homo habilis. Right, what was the common name for Homo habilis?
Handyman.
So this one was Handyman. Why was he called Handyman? Yeah, so the first one to use tools, eh? Right, who discovered Homo habilis?
Mary.
Yeah, it's Mary and Louis Leakey. Right, where?
In Tanzania.
So you need to know all of this. All of it, you need to know it. And I'm glad you do. Right. And then we had Homo erectus. Homo erectus. Right. What was the common name for Homo erectus?
Right.
Upright man. Right. Who discovered upright man?
Eugene.
It was Eugene. Du Bois. Right. Where did Eugene Du Bois discover this fossil?
In Indonesia.
Right. And then the last one was?
Homo sapien.
Right. Common name for Homo sapien? It was wise man. Right. Where did they discover? Oh, discovered wise man. Tim White, where? In Limpopo. Right, that is fossil evidence. So now we are done with fossil evidence. Actually, we are done with paper two. We've moved. Nyajal. Aye. Sebasha is on. Sebafugla. All right. Now we come to cultural evidence. But cultural evidence and cultural evidence and genetic evidence is explained better in the Out of Africa hypothesis. So let's just go straight to Out of Africa hypothesis. Right, Out of Africa hypothesis. All right, who can tell me what does the Out of Africa hypothesis state?
All present day.
All modern life forms originated from Africa and migrated to other parts of the world. That is the Out of Africa hypothesis. You're free to marks. All modern humans originated from Africa and migrated to other parts of the world. Out of Africa. Hypothesis. Right. It states that all modern humans, all modern humans originated from Africa. From Africa and migrated to other parts of the world. That's Out of Africa hypothesis. All modern humans originated from Africa and migrated. All modern humans originated from Africa and migrated to other parts of the world. That is the Out of Africa hypothesis. Right. Now, what is the evidence for Out of Africa hypothesis? People, this one is very important. It will be there. I feel it. They will ask you, explain how fossil evidence.
GPS signal lost.
Okay, sorry. All right. Explain how fossil evidence shows the evidence of Out of Africa hypothesis. Right. Number one, fossil evidence. Fossil. You are going to say fossils of Ardipithecus were found in Africa only. Ardipithecus found in Africa. Only. Right, that is 2 marks. Fossils of Ardipithecus were found in Africa only. Right, number 2. Fossils of Australopithecus and Homo habilis. Australopithecus and Homo habilis. Were found in Africa. Only 4 marks. Number 3, you are going to say the oldest fossil of Homo sapien was found in Africa. So this is fossil evidence. Fossils of Ardipithecus were found in Africa only. Fossils of Australopithecus and Homo habilis were found in Africa only. And then the oldest fossil of Homo sapien was found in Africa. So you need to know this fossil evidence by heart. Right, and then now we come to cultural evidence. We are trying to explain that all modern humans originated from Africa and migrated to other parts of the world. Right, so now we have cultural evidence. All right, cultural evidence. Cultural evidence. Right. So, now in cultural evidence, we are going to explain how does cultural evidence serve or support the out of Africa hypothesis. Right. Now, the use of tools improved human nutrition. And when you look at evolution, the development of tools became more sophisticated as homo needs evolve. Right. So the first fossil to ever use tools was found in Africa, and his name was Homo habilis. Right, when we talk about culture, we are talking about the way of life. Right, you are talking about the way of life. Right, so the first man to ever use tools was found in Africa. That is cultural evidence, which means all modern humans really originated from Africa, because now tools are used everywhere. Right, then the last one is genetic evidence. Genetic evidence. Right, when we are talking about genetic evidence, we are talking about mitochondrial Eve. Right, so here you are going to say the analysis of the mitochondrial DNA shows that the oldest female was found in Africa, and her name was mitochondrial Eve.
Yeah.
Right. So mitochondrial DNA comes from the maternal lineage, right? Right. So when they were analyzing the mutation on the mitochondrial DNA, they found out that the oldest female was found in Africa, and her name was mitochondrial Eve. Right. That is genetic evidence. Right. And so we are done. We are done. Oh, phylogenetic tree. Aye, aye, aye. We must finish now. Right. Shh. Now let's look at few questions and then, yeah. Remember, the warmer the blanket, the colder the future. All right. All right, now let's look at evolution. Question number one. Question number one. tabulates three differences between Lamarckism and Darwinism. Right. Let's look at the differences between Lamarckism and Darwinism. People, are we together?
Yes.
Right. So we have Lamarck and then we have Darwin. Right. So the first difference is that when we look at Lamarck, in Lamarck, there is no variation. Whereas in Darwin, there is variation. That's number one. What is the second difference? Or should I give you 5 minutes to do it and then we do corrections? What's another difference between Lamarck and Darwin? Yeah, so in Lamarck, in Lamarck, not all offsprings are affected there. It's only those ones that are determined to change that change. Yeah, so in Lamarck, individual changes, whereas in Darwin, the whole population. Changes.
So, can you also say Lamarck says that organisms evolve because they want to, and then Darwin says the environment and is going to evolve.
Not necessarily, but what we can say is that in Lamarck, characteristics are acquired, whereas in Darwin, characteristics are inherited. Right? Very important. Right? So this is a difference between Lamarckism and Darwinism. Right? Again, I'm recapping. The first difference is that in Lamarck, there's no variation. In Darwin, there's variation. And then in Lamarck, individuals change. Whereas in Darwin, the whole population changes. And then in Lamarck, characteristics are acquired. And then in Darwin, characteristics are inherited. All right. So we move on to the different, to another question, sorry. Where is this food? All right. Now the question is, are we reading the question? Right. Ancestors of duck did not have webbed feet. Are you seeing it? So the ancestors did not have webbed feet. In terms of natural selection, explain how the webbed feet could have evolved. Explain how the ancestors of ducks did not have webbed feet. In terms of natural selection, explain how the webbed feet could have evolved. All right, let's do it. There's a great deal of variation amongst the ancestors of ducks. Some ducks had webbed feet, and some ducks did not have webbed feet. When there was a change in the environment, The ducks that had wet feet survived. And the ones that did not have wet feet, they died. Ne? Right. The ones that survived reproduced and passed on the allele of having wet feet to their offsprings. Ne? Then eventually, there's a great proportion of ducks that has wet feet. Yes, yes. Yeah. So here the competition is not stated, no? But you can state it. You can say maybe the ducks had to swim because these webbed feet, they are used to swim. But since here it's not mentioned, I don't think it's compulsory. Right, and then question number 3. Describe how speciation occurs when a population becomes separated by a geographical barrier. So we've done this one, isn't it? Right, if a population of a single species becomes separated by a geographical barrier, the population will split into two. There is now no gene flow between the two populations. Since the two populations are exposed to different environmental conditions, natural selection will take place independently in each population, such that the two populations become different from each other genotypically and phenotypically. Even if they were to mix again, they would not interbreed and produce fertile offspring. All right, question number 4. Study 3 diagrams, diagram A, B, C, and C below that shows the mechanism used to explain evolution. Right. Okay. Okay, we've seen the diagram. Let's just memorize the diagram. Here's a diagram. Right, here's a diagram. So we have roots. These are roots. Some they are long and some they are short. And then in diagram B, we can see that the short roots, all of them, the trees with short roots or plants with short roots, what happened to them? They died. Are you seeing it? Yeah, they died. All of them, they died. And then in diagram number C, we can see that the new offsprings are developing what? Long roots. This is obviously natural selection, right? So you can see that there's a great deal of variation among the roots of the plants. Right, some plants have long roots and some plants have short roots. Right, when there's a change in the environment, can be drought, the plants with long roots survive because they could reach groundwater or water table. And the plants with short roots, they die because they cannot reach groundwater. They are no longer there. These plants with long roots, they reproduce and pass on the allele of long roots to their offsprings. And then eventually, there's a great proportion of plants that has long roots. They are called cutty plants. All right. Okay, so it says, from a comparison, picture A and B, describe the feature of the cuts that have enabled them to survive long periods of hot and dry weathers. The answer there is long roots. Right. And then 4.2, name the mechanism put forward by Darwin to explain his theory of evolution that illustrates in the diagram. What is that? Natural selection. Then they say, use the 3 diagrams to explain the mechanism that you've mentioned. Right, I've already explained it, isn't it?
Yes.
Right, now let's come to question number 5. People, are you following? Or is it learning? Right. They are saying study the diagram below that shows the change in the number of black and white mice living in an environment with light scent. Okay. Shh. Right. Study the diagram below that shows the change in the number of black and white mice living in an environment with light colored scent. So the land is light colored. The mice are white, others are black. Obviously, the white ones are going to be camouflaged, isn't it?
Yes.
The black ones will be exposed. Mm. Right. 5.1. What phenomena is illustrated in the diagram?
Natural selection.
Describe how the sequence of events A, B, and C represent the phenomenon. Right. Let's go back. Right, Stini, there was a great deal of variation amongst the mice. Yeah? Some mice were white and some mice were black. Are we together? Right. When the predators came, the white mice survived because they were camouflaged by the light-colored scent, and the black mice died because they were exposed by the light-colored scent. The mice that survived reproduced and passed on the allele of being white to their next generation. Then eventually, all the mice, oh no, there was a great proportion of mice that was white, isn't it?
Yeah.
Right. 5.3. Will the next generation of mice population more likely be all white or all black? The answer is all white. Right, question number 6. Study the diagram below showing a process of evolution. Diagram 1, 2, and 3 shows the sequence of events that occurred in the rabbit population. Right, okay. Okay, so now there's a river here. We know a river is a geographical barrier, isn't it? Right. This river was found on the site. People A. And then there was gene flow, which means these rabbits were able to interpret, isn't it? And pass on their genes. Right. In diagram 2, I don't know whether that is called river capture or what. Right, or stream pirates. All right, now listen, game. This river started bending downwards. Are you seeing it? Yeah, so it started bending downward and it separated the populations. Now we have population A and population B. Right, in diagram number 3. Right, in diagram number 3, there is now no gene flow. Right, and since there's no gene flow, obviously, they cannot interbreed anymore. And they're exposed to different environmental conditions. Natural selection took place independently and they became different from each other. Right, so we ended up with species X and species Y. Wow. Right, 6.1. Name the evolutionary process represented by the sequence of events shown in diagram 1, 2, and 3. It's speciation. Speciation. Right. Describe the process stated using the diagrams above. So we are going to say right, there was once one population of rabbits, ne? Right, this population of rabbits was separated by the river. The population split into two. We had population A and population B. Since these two populations are exposed to different environmental conditions, Did you mention gene flow? No. All right, let's start afresh. Right, we said that there was once one population of rabbits, ne? Then this population was separated by the river. The population split into two. We had population A and population B. There was no gene flow between the two populations. And since the two populations were exposed to different environmental conditions, natural selection took place independently in each population, such that the two populations became different from each other genotypically and phenotypically. Hence the formation of species X and species Y. Even if these species can mix again, they would not interbreed and produce a fertile offspring. Right, question number seven. Right, the diagram below represent the evolution of horse compiled from a fossil record. Right, so we have a modern horse. And now let's look at their legs and their toes. Now 7.1. How many times is the modern horse taller than the earliest ancestor? Now this is an earliest ancestor. Yeah? They are saying how many times is the modern horse taller than the earliest ancestor. So you're going to say 1.6 divided by 0.4. Then you're going to get an answer. What is the answer there?
You say it's 1.6 minus
0.4. Yeah. No, it's 1.6 divided by 0.4.
It's 4.
It's four. Okay, which means the answer is four times. So we said 1.6 divided by 0.4. Then you see the answer is four times. Right. And then 7.2. What happened to the appearance of the feet of the horses over time? What happened to the appearance of the feet? Right. So now we can see there's feet here. Toes. Eh? And then over time, they started doing what? Shrinking. Isn't it? Right. Paleontologists suggest that the ancestor horses lived in forest, but modern horses lived in open grass. Explain one way in which the modern horse is adapted to open grassland. One way in which the modern horse is adapted to live in a grassland. Here's a... Sorry? It is used. Eh? What is she saying? Yes, good. It has wolves. Right. Now, question number 8.
Last one.
The last one.
Yes.
Say amen. All right. So, the red-bellied snakes and the green tree snakes are predators that sometimes feed on the kentots, nototmos, frogs, that contain a toxin that may kill them. So these snakes, they feed on the tots that has toxin which may kill them. Right? So the snakes consume the tots by swallowing them whole. So they just eat them whole. A decrease in the average jaw size of the snake has been observed over a period of 70 years. Right. Which means these snakes, now, the red-bellied ones and the green ones, they're the larger jaw size. So, or rather, maybe there was variation. There were some with the larger jaw size and there were some with a smaller jaw size. Right? The ones with the larger jaw size, they are the ones that swallowed the tots that had toxin. So all those that had a larger jaw size, they did what? They died. All right, let's look at the questions. Okay, the question is, define punctuated equilibrium. Can you see how many marks? 3 marks. Define punctuated equilibrium. Right. So we are going to say punctuated equilibrium. It's a hypothesis that explains the speed at which evolution takes place. Then you further explain that it states that evolution involves a long period of time where there is no change and a short period of time where there's rapid change through natural selection. Right. And then 8.2. What characteristic of tort species protected from the predators? Toxin. Contains toxin. Right. Now, 8.3. Explain how the change in jaw size helped the snakes to survive. So they are saying that the snakes consume the tort by swallowing them whole. A decrease. So there was a decrease in the average jaw size of snakes. So how did that save them? The smaller the jaw size. So as the jaw size decreased, it meant that the snakes could no longer swallow the tots. Isn't it?
Yes.
And that made them, or that protected them from the toxin that is produced by the tots. Yeah, because they were swallowing the tots as holes. They were killed by the poison.
This
is sport. Right. Now, 8.4. How would Lamarck have explained the development of small jaws in the snakes? All right, so I think Lamarck would have said, okay, so the snakes saw that the tots are toxic, or they have toxin, ne? So they did not use, or rather originally, snakes had a larger or a bigger jaw size. They did not use their jaw size more often to swallow the tots. As a result, their jaw size decreased and became smaller. And the characteristics of small jaws was then passed on to the next generation. I just want something that has to do with human evolution, then we are done.
Okay, so last one. I shouldn't miss the third last one.
Okay, let's do this one. 29, the last one. Last one, eh? Last one. All right. Question 29. It says, Professor Libega and his colleagues studied the fossils they found in the cave at the Cradle of Humankind. The skeletons from the cave are ranked among the most complete finds to date. The adult female Australopithecus sediba was remarkably well preserved, and some of the following characteristics were identified. Right, so Australopithecus sediba had a small brain size, was bipedal, smaller canines, projecting nose, and a smaller body size. Right. Question 29.1. Write down three characteristics from